Hello and welcome to today's lecture on instruction pipelining, and particularly we shall focus on pipeline hazards in this lecture. And briefly we can recapitulate what we discussed in the last lecture. You may recall that I mentioned that as computers execute billions of instructions per second, pipelining instruction execution is the most common approach to improve CPU's performance. So, since that is the primary job of a processor, fetch and execute instructions, instruction pipelining is profitable and widely used since 1980s. And I mentioned that main idea behind pipelining, instruction pipelining, is to divide instruction execution across several stages. That means, we divide it into subtasks, and then across different stages it is divided, and each stage accesses only a subset of the CPU's resources that I have elaborated in details. And particularly we have considered a classic 5-stage RISC pipeline as an example, where the pipeline is divided into 5 stages: instruction fetch, instruction decode, execute, memory read or write, and then write back. And different instructions are in different stages of execution simultaneously, and how it happens and how with the help of pipeline registers this is maintained, I have discussed in detail. And we have also seen that if the ideal conditions are satisfied, then it is possible to input one instruction at a time or produce result for one instruction at a time. So, it gives you a CPU of CPI is equal to 1 cycles per instruction, that is equal to 1 in the ideal situation. Question naturally arises, whether this is true for all possible situations. And I mentioned about a parameter speed up, and we have seen only when we are executing large number of operations, then only you get the, you reach the ideal speed up. And as you can see, if you have got k stages, then if the number of operations is very few, then you can see the speed up factor is initially 1 if the number of operation is only 1. If the number of operation increases, in our case number of instructions increases to be executed, then you can see the speed up increases gradually, and it attains a value of k, that is the number of stages, only when you have got very large number of instructions getting executed. So, is true for any value of k. For k is equal to 10, this same is the situation. And we have also discussed about the limits on pipeline stages. The number of stages, if you increase, it helps you in improving the performance because speed up increases. But as you increase the number of stages, we have seen we have to add pipeline register as you add a new stage. So, that is an overhead. As you keep on adding number of stages, you have to keep on adding the pipeline registers as well. And as you keep on adding the pipeline registers with the number of stages, the overhead keeps on increasing. And as a consequence, you can see the cost performance, the performance cost ratio does not really increase linearly as the value of k increases. So, it increases and then attains a peak value, and if you further increase the number of stages, then the performance degrades, and that actually puts a limit on the number of stages that a pipeline processor should have. And this particular optimal value are being tried in modern processors, and the number of stages is increased as many as possible, but obviously there is a upper limit beyond which it does not give you good result. So, then the resources keeps on increasing as the number of k increases, resource requirement keeps on increasing. Okay. Now, today we shall focus on pipeline hazards. Question arises, should we expect a CPI of 1 in practice? If CPI is 1, then it is the ideal situation, ideal conditions are met. What were the ideal conditions? Number one ideal condition was that the instructions are independent. They can be executed independent of each other, and only then you can achieve a CPI is equal to 1. But unfortunately, we cannot have complete independent, the instructions cannot be fully independent, and so we cannot really get a CPI of 1, and there is some limit, and that limit is imposed by hazards. So, we shall discuss about hazards. What is a hazard? Hazards are circumstances that prevent the next instruction in the instruction stream from executing during the designated clock cycle. We have seen, we are fetching in our program order, we have a sequence of instruction 1 followed by instruction 2 followed by instruction 3 followed by instruction 4 and so on. So, now we would like to execute these instructions one after the other, and whenever you do pipelining, we are obviously doing some kind of overlapped execution. Now, whenever you are trying to do it in this way, you will find that where I3 should have been executed, we are not able to do because of hazard, or where I4 is supposed to be executed cannot be executed because of dependence among the instructions, and that is known as hazard. And the hazards can be broadly divided into 3 major types. What are the 3 major types? Number one is structural hazards, and structural hazards arises when you do not have enough resources to keep all the instructions moving. Initially, in our ideal situation, we assume that there is no resource constraint. But this cannot be really true in practice, because always there will be some resource constraint, because you would like to optimize the performance for a given cost. So, the cost will keep on increasing as you put additional resources in the system. So, there will be the structural hazard will not arise if you have unlimited resources. But whenever you impose some restriction on the resources, then structural hazard arises. How? I shall explain with the help of an example, but before that let me explain the other 2 types of hazards. Second type of hazard is known as data hazards. So, that data hazards arises because data results of earlier instructions not available yet. That means, what can happen, suppose these are the instructions which you are executing one after the other, that instruction 2 may require some data which is produced by instruction I1, and whenever I2 is trying to read that data, then I1 has not yet written it into the register. So, we have seen that primary means by which the data flow is taking place is through registers, because all the ALU operations are involving registers. So, in case of our RISC processor. So, if the result is not yet written into the register, then if the same data is needed by a subsequent instruction, then this data hazard will occur. Third type of hazard is known as control hazards. Control decisions resulting from earlier instructions not yet made, so do not know which new instruction to execute. So, whenever you will find that there is a if then else type of statements present in your program. Now, that condition for which I mean condition on which that branching defense, if something is true, then it will execute a code sequence. If that is, if the condition is not true, then it will execute another code sequence. But if the condition is not yet known, then which code sequence to be executed? Because if the code sequence to be executed is known, then the processor can fetch from the memory that particular code sequence. But if that is known, then processor needs to wait till the decision is known, and that leads to what is known as control hazard. So I shall elaborate these hazards one after the other. First, let us focus on structural hazard. These structural hazards occur when two or more instructions need the same resource. We have seen that an instruction is divided into, say, classically 5 stages. Say I1, we have got instruction fetch, instruction decode, then instruction execution, then memory operation, then write back. So, this is for instruction 2, we are executing in overlapped manner. So, this is cycle 1, this is cycle 2, cycle 3, 4, 5. Then instruction fetch, instruction decode, instruction execution, memory operation, and write back. So this is how it happens: instruction fetch, instruction decode, that is instruction execution, memory operation, and so on. So this is how the instructions are executed in this way, and in this direction you have got the clock cycle or time. Now we find that whenever we go to this particular point, say you have got instruction 4, where instruction fetch, instruction decode is going on. Now if you look at this point, here we are performing some memory operation and also we are performing instruction fetch. Now if you have got one common memory, if you have got one common memory, then what will happen? These two operations cannot be performed simultaneously. This particular instruction 1 will be writing some data into a it will involve memory, that means it will access memory, maybe load or store, whatever it may be. And here the instruction 4 is being fetched, that is also stored in memory. That means for instruction and data we have common memory, then there will be a hazard here, because you may recall that in our earlier processors, like in Princeton architecture proposed by von Neumann, there we had got only one memory, common memory. So if you have got only one memory, then there will be a structural hazard at this point. Similarly, for example, here you are doing instruction execution and instruction fetch, instruction decode, instruction execution, and instruction execution may involve some computation. It will always involve some kind of computation. Now whenever you are performing instruction fetch and instruction execution, you are doing instruction execution and instruction fetch and instruction decode, in such cases also you will see you will require some adders to generate the next address. Whenever you are doing instruction fetch, you are calculating the next address, and whenever you are performing instruction execution, you are using the adder. So in these two cases, if you use the same ALU to perform both the thing, that means calculation of the next address as well as I mean computation of the operation, addition, subtraction, whatever it may be, then again there will be an hazard. And that is the reason why you may have noticed in our simple pipeline, we had got separate adder, and also in addition to that the arithmetic and logic unit ALU. So, it is not done by the same ALU. So, what we are doing? We are adding additional resources so that this happens. So, in this particular diagram, we have seen that if we have a shared memory, then you have to no other alternative but to stall the execution. In other words, what we will do, that instruction fetch of the fourth instruction is delayed till the fifth cycle, and you are losing one instruction cycle. So, one cycle is lost whenever you have got a single memory, and that is the reason why that Harvard architecture is used. Harvard architecture, where we have got two separate memories, one for data and another for instruction. So, whenever you have got two separate memories, no problem. This particular operation will involve the data memory, access of data memory, and this particular here if you fetch the instruction, then it will involve program memory. So, the hazard is overcome. So, this is how with the help of additional resources you can overcome the structural hazard. So, a pipeline stalled for a structural hazard when both instructions and data share the same memory, shown is in this particular example. Now, question is what are the different ways by which structural hazards can be overcome? Number one is duplicate resources. As we have already seen, we are duplicating the resources, adding more memories, adding adders, such that the structural hazard is overcome. Another alternative way of overcoming structural hazard is to pipeline the resource. So, a particular resource may be pipelined. So, if you can pipeline a particular resource, it can be an ALU, it can be some other resource memory. If you can pipeline its operation, then what you can do, since in a pipeline system we have seen different operations can be performed for different tasks in an overlapped manner. So, there also it is possible to overcome structural hazard, but all resources cannot be pipelined, unfortunately. So, if a particular resource can be pipelined, then instead of duplicating, you will go for pipelining the resource. That will be more cost effective, in the sense pipelining involves much lesser cost than duplicating a resource. So, this is a better alternative, but that alternative may not be always possible, and not that is why duplicating resources is commonly used, because it is simple, easy to implement and always possible. Then reorder the instructions. So, this is the third alternative, where whenever you are facing some hazard, for example, if there is any way by which two instructions are causing some kind of hazard. So, what you can do, the instruction sequence can be changed, that you can reorder the sequence of instructions. So, without affecting the result, that means the program flow, without affecting the program flow. Program flow means that was intended in your source program, whatever outcome was expected, that output should be obtained. Without violating that, if you can reorder the instructions and overcome the hazard, that is also possible. So, you can reorder instructions, and it may be too expensive to eliminate a structural hazard, in which case pipelining should stall. So, the last resort is to stall the pipeline. So, whenever none of them is physical, duplicating resource is very expensive, pipelining is not feasible, reordering of instructions is not feasible, in such case you have no other alternative but to stall the instruction for a cycle, and that will definitely overcome the structural hazard. So, whenever you are doing this, no new instruction is issued until the hazard has been resolved. So, in the previous case we have seen just by introducing one bubble, one stall, we are able to overcome the structural hazard for our 5-stage pipeline. Okay. So, we have discussed about the structural hazard. Now, let us focus on data hazard. So, what is the primary reason for data hazard that we shall explore? As I mentioned, our earlier assumption that instructions are independent is not true. There will be dependencies. So, dependencies are the root cause of data hazard. So, we shall do the analysis of different types of dependencies to understand why data hazard occurs and how it occurs. So, first of all, you should understand these two aspects. Number one is dependencies are property of program. That means, that property of program is independent of the machine implementation. A program has been written, a source code is there, and that source code has incorporated some dependencies among different instructions. So, this is independent of the processor. So, that part is the property of programs that cannot be changed by whenever you go for implementation. Secondly, whether a dependence leads to an actual hazards and whether the hazard actually causes a stall are properties of the pipeline organization. That means, these two aspects are different. One is the property of the programs, another is outcome of the pipeline organization. That means, whether a particular dependence will lead to some hazard and stall, that will depend how the pipelining is done. And there are three main types of dependencies in a program. We shall explore three main types of dependencies. Number one is known as data dependencies, second is known as name dependencies, third is known as control dependencies. So, let us try to understand these three different types of dependencies that is inherently present in a program. So, first we shall focus on data dependencies. So, an instruction J is data dependent on instruction I, if either of the following conditions hold. Number one is there is direct data dependence. Instruction I produces a result that is used by instruction J, as it is shown in this particular code R1 of operation R2, you are performing some arithmetic or logical operation on the content of R1 with that of the content of R2, and you are storing the result in register R3. Now, that register R3 is being used as the source of operation in the second instruction, where you are performing the content of R3 operation, content of R4, and the result is being stored in R5. So, in this case you can see there is a direct data dependence, that instruction 2 is data dependent on the instruction 1. So, or you can say this is the J and this is I. Instruction J is data dependent on instruction I. So, this is the direct data dependence, and it may not be always direct data dependence may not be always present. The data dependence can be transitive in nature. So, in such a case, instruction J is data dependent on instruction K, and instruction K is data dependent on instruction I, as it is illustrated with the help of this example here. As you can see, that second instruction is data dependent on the first instruction, but the third instruction is not data dependent on first instruction directly, but you can see the second instruction is data dependent on the first instruction and third instruction is data dependent on the second instruction. So, there is a kind of transitive relationship on data dependency, and here we can say that this R5, that third instruction is also data dependent on first instruction, may not be directly, but there is a transitive data dependence. However, dependence within a single instruction such as add D, add double R1, R2 is not considered as dependence. So, this cannot be considered as dependence because in this case all the three operands are involving same registers, and this is not treated as a dependence. Now, let us come to another example. If two instructions are data dependent, they cannot be executed simultaneously or be completely overlapped. Why it is necessary to analyze data dependence is very clear, because whenever we try to implement pipelining and try to execute in an overlapped manner, that will lead to hazard and we have to stall. That is the reason why if two instructions are data dependent, they cannot be executed simultaneously or be completely overlapped. Either they cannot be completely overlapped or simultaneously they cannot be executed. So, let us look at this program loop LD F0, 0, R1. Here as you can see, the F0 is the source of operand in the next instruction. So, there is direct data dependence between these two, and also there is direct data dependence between first and third. So, floating point operations are being performed in the subsequent by this operation, and first in the first instruction you are loading a particular operand, a scalar value into a register F0, then you are performing addition with the content of a register F2 and storing the result in F4, and again here also we are using you are storing the value. Then the data that is F4 is being loaded in the stored in the memory, that is the instruction that is being performed. And here also you can see that R1, R2, R8 and here branch not equal, here also there is data dependence because you are performing some kind of subtraction. You are so that the it is acting as a pointer, so it points to the next element, and that is the reason why it is being done. And in the next instruction, branch operation is dependent on that, so there is a dependency here. So in this particular loop, you find that there are several data dependencies present, even within this straight line code that is present, and in this program. So, a data dependence conveys three things. Why it is necessary to analyze data dependent? Because a data dependence will lead to three things, or it conveys three things. That first of all is there is a possibility of hazards. So, if there is data dependence, there is a possibility of hazard. Second is the order in which the results must be calculated. That means, the order in which the instructions are appearing, which is known as program order, that program order needs to be maintained, and data dependence also ensures that the maintenance of this program order. And this data dependence also gives an idea of the upper bound on how much parallelism can be exploited. So, later on you will see we shall not only restrict to pipelining, we shall go for other type of processing like superscalar architecture, VLIW architecture, where there will be multiple processing elements. So, where we shall be trying to exploit instruction level parallelism in a little different way. So, So there also you will find that you will be executing some operations in parallel. Now, what kind of instruction level parallelism in addition to pipelining, whenever we shall go for other types of instruction level parallelism, what is the degree of parallelism that is present in the program, inherent in the program, that will decide the order of this upper bound on how much parallelism that is present. So, this data dependency analysis is very important because of these three issues. So, as I mentioned, data dependence can limit the instruction level parallelism. A dependence can be overcome in two different ways. Now, suppose you have identified that there is a data dependence. So, in such a case, what are you going to do? There are two possible alternatives. Number one is you will maintain the dependence by avoiding a hazard. So, you will maintain the dependence and you will also try to avoid the hazard somehow, how that we shall discuss in detail little later. So, this is one possibility that without changing the data dependence, you will somehow avoid data hazards or avoid stalls. That is one possibility. Second alternative is that you will modify the code itself. That means, you will eliminate a dependence by transforming the code. You will modify the program such that the data dependence which was existing is eliminated. So, thereby avoiding hazards and stalls, which is outcome of the data dependence. Now, question is, how do you really detect data dependence? So, data dependence may flow between instructions in two ways. Number one is through registers, number two is through memory locations. So, by looking at the program, you can detect data dependence if same register is involved or if some memory address is involved. So, whenever same registers involved through which data flow is taking place, then it is very easy to detect data dependence. That means, when data flow is through register, detection is rather straightforward. On the other hand, when data flow is through memory location, detection is very difficult. Detection cannot be done very easily whenever it is through registers. Let us consider two different examples why it is difficult. Two addresses may refer to the same memory location, but look different. For example, you have used two separate instructions. In one instruction, you have used this R4. This is the address that is being generated. That means, in this case, the effective address is equal to content of R4 plus 100, that is the effective address. So, this is how the effective address is calculated, and another instruction is there where the effective address is the instruction is this, operand address is specified by this. So, in this case, the effective address is equal to content of R6 plus 20. Now, it may so happen that this effective address 1 and effective address 2 may be same. So, if you analyze the program, then you can see although the addresses generated are same, but by observing the program, it is not possible to say that the effective address will be same. The reason for that is the value which will be present in R4 and value that is present in R6 can be dynamically modified while executing a program, because memory locations the effective address that will be generated by calculating with the content of a register and some displacement that is provided as part of the instruction, that cannot be detected simply by observing the program. Similarly, there is another example: the effective address may differ from one instruction to the other. So, in the second case, for example, in two different instances in the instruction sequence, you have the same register in and same displacement. Now, what can happen in between? The register value may have been changed. So, although these two may appear that these two will produce the same effective address, but in reality they may not generate the same effective address. The reason for that is that value of R4 may be dynamically changed while executing instructions. So, in this case we find that whenever the data dependence when the data flow take place through memory, then it is difficult. So, later on we shall discuss about how this detection can be done whenever it involves memory, but whenever it is involving registers, it is rather easy to detect. Now, the second type of dependency is known as name dependencies. So, name dependencies are two instructions use the same register or memory location called a name. So, there is no true flow of data between the two instructions. We have taken up an example. Let us consider one example is say A is equal to B plus C, and another is A is equal to P plus Q. Now, here what you are doing, you are adding the value taken from maybe memory location where B is stored and another memory location where C is stored, and then you are storing in a memory A. Similarly, here you have got another instruction where you are storing in same memory, but the operands P and Q are different. Now, in this particular case, there is no data dependence in the sense there is no flow of data from one instruction to another, but this will also lead to a kind of dependence, and there are two types of dependencies. One is known as anti dependence, another is known as output dependence. So, let us see what are these two dependencies, what is anti dependence and what is output dependence. So, anti dependence occurs between two instructions I and J. If J writes to a register or memory location that I reads, original ordering must be preserved to ensure that I reads the correct value. So, here as you can see, in the first case, you are reading an operand from register 8. And then performing this operation add the content of F6, you are adding with the content of F8, then storing the result in F0. Now, you have got another instruction which is following the first instruction where you are storing the result in F8. F8 is equal to content of F4 plus content of F5. So, in the first case, what is happening? F0 is where you are storing F6 plus F8, and the second one, this is your addition, and in the second case you are performing F8 is equal to F4 minus F5. So, this is what you are doing. Now, this is the program order. Now, it may so happen that this particular instruction will be executed before this instruction. So, if this happens, then what will happen? Then whatever value was intended to be read by the first instruction, you will get a different value because it has been changed by a subsequent instruction. So, a subsequent instruction has modified it and then you are reading it. So, you will not get the correct result. So, this is called the anti-dependence. So, this anti-dependence is arising whenever that program order is not being followed strictly, and that will happen particularly later on we shall see in superscalar architecture this can happen. So, this is known as anti-dependence. Now, let us consider the output dependences. So, output dependence occurs between two instruction I and J if and only if the two instructions write to the same register or memory location. Now, the ordering of the instructions must be preserved to ensure such that whenever in the same register or memory location two instructions are writing. Now, if the order is changed, the finally what value will flow will be different. That is why instead of finally written value corresponds to J instead of I. So, that can happen if the program flow will decide one particular order and outcome of result is dependent on that, but the execution order may be little different, and in such a case there will be the result will not be correct, and that is known as output dependences. And name dependences are not true dependences. Why we are calling name dependence? Because registers and memory locations are essentially considered as names in which you are storing the operands. How can you overcome this? This output dependences are not really true data dependences, and they can be very easily overcome by a technique known as register renaming. So, later on I shall discuss about it in more details. You can modify the name of the registers, you can rename the registers, and this problem will be overcome. So, these output dependencies can be overcome, and then you can change the order of the execution. Finally, the third type of dependencies is known as control dependencies. So, it determines the ordering of an instruction with respect of the branch instruction. For example, here if P is true, P 1 is true, then S 1, and you have got another if then else statement, if P 2 is true, then S 2. Now, whenever we have got this type of if then else type of statements present in your program, we call S 1 is control dependent on P 1, because if P 1 is true, only then you are doing this, then S 1, else something else you will do. And similarly, S 2 is control dependent on P 2. Now, whenever this kind of control dependencies are present, an instruction that is control dependent on a branch cannot be moved before the branch. That means, an instruction that is present in S 1 cannot be moved before P 1, because then you may not get correct result if you move some instruction from that then part of the program before that if this instruction P 1. So, this would not be done. Similarly, an instruction that is not control dependent on a branch cannot be moved after the branch. That means, some instruction which is present before if P I should not be moved to this part, that means then part. So, that also should not be done, because in such a case that particular instruction will become control dependent on P 1, which was not true earlier. That means, so whenever you do some kind of reordering of instructions, you have to consider these dependencies, and you should not modify the program in such a way. So, when program order is strictly preserved, it ensures that control dependencies are also preserved. So, essential requirement is to maintain the program order, and if it is strictly preserved, then control dependencies are also preserved. For example, a simple example has been taken here. Say the first two instructions are data dependent. So, they cannot be reordered, but you can see. So, here it is producing some value which is stored in R2 that is being used in the second instruction, branch instruction. So, you have got data dependence. So, this data dependency can be very easily detected, and obviously while executing your program, that program order will be maintained. But you can see the second and third instruction BQZ R2 comma L1, and here you have got load R1 comma 0 R2. Here you can see there is no as such data dependence, there is no flow of data between these two instructions. However, you cannot really reorder these two instructions, because if you do the reordering of these instructions, then this may lead to incorrect results, because whenever you are executing in this program in a dynamic situation, the input to an instruction may come from multiple sources, and there is a possibility of coming the input from multiple sources, and that is dynamically dependent on the execution when you execute a program. So, this particular although there is no data dependence, but if you try to reorder these two instructions, it may lead to problem. Now, I have already discussed about the data hazards in detail. It arises out of change of relative timing of the instructions by overlapping their execution. So, here we have got a simple program, and there is lot of data dependencies. You can see that R1, the result is being stored in R1 in the first instruction, which is used as a source of one of the operands in the second instruction, that is also used as source of operand in the third instruction. Now, a chain of instructions, several instructions one after the other, is data dependent on the first instruction. Now, how long this data dependence will persist whenever you go for pipelined execution? Actually, it depends on the pipeline depth, and data dependence does not always mean that it will lead to hazard. So, let us see this particular diagram. This will help you to understand how and when it happens. So, you can see here the four instructions following this first instruction add R1 comma R2 comma R3. You have got four instructions serve R4 comma R1 comma R3 and R6 comma R1 comma R7 or RO comma R1 comma R9, then XOR R10 comma R1 comma R11. So, you find all the subsequent four instruction is data dependent on the first instruction, but will all of them lead to data hazard and stalls? So, you can see here writing of the result is taking place in the fifth cycle. If you look at the execution of the first instruction, instruction fetch, instruction decode, execution, then that memory operation which is not present in this instruction, but that cycle will be necessary. So, in the fifth cycle you are writing the result into the register. So, we find that before the fifth cycle was reached, in the third cycle itself, second instruction has already read the data. So, there is a red line, and which implies that here there is a hazard, data hazard. Similarly, in this case also, before the writing of the value in the register took place, the reading of the operand took place in the third instruction. So, as a consequence, you can see there will be a hazard for the second instruction as well, but so far as the third and fourth instructions are concerned, they will not be it will not lead to any hazard, because what has been done a technique known as split cycle has been used, where writing is done in the first phase of the clock. So, you have a clock has got two phases. So, you are performing writing in this phase, and reading you are performing in the second phase. So, this is a particular clock cycle. So, whenever you do this split phase, then only that third instruction will not suffer from hazard. If a split cycle is not done, then the third instruction also will suffer data hazard. So, in this particular case, it is not read, because you have been, you are able to read the register value after it has been written. So, we find that although there are four instructions, consecutive instructions are data dependent on the first instruction, but only the first two is leading to data hazard, the next two there is no data hazard. So, you can classify the data hazards with the help of three different ways. So, classification of data hazards. First one, say let's assume that we have got an instruction I be an earlier instruction, j is a later one. Then read after write hazard. Read after write hazard is defined as j tries to read a value before I writes into it, which is known as read after write hazard, as it is shown here. This is the read after write hazard. You are writing some value in a register, in the second instruction is reading the value, read after write. Then second one is write after write. I and j write to the same place, but in the wrong order. So, you can see they are writing in the same place, but you know, if their order is different, then it will lead to an hazard known as write after write hazard. So, only occurs in more than one pipeline stage can write. So, in our case, that simple 5-stage pipeline that we have already discussed, where the second type of data hazard, that is write after write type of data hazard, will not be present. You can think over it and you will see this will not be present. Then third type of hazard, data hazard, that is known as write after read. So, in this case, j writes a new value to a location before I has read the old value. So, j writes to a new value before I has read it. So, in this also will not occur in our 5-stage pipeline. So, this occurs only when if writes can happen before the reads. In our case, we have seen that write operation take place at the last cycle. So, before that read will always take place. So, this type of hazard will not be present in the 5-stage pipeline that we have already discussed. So, we can conclude our lecture with these statements. Do all kinds of data hazard translate into pipeline stalls? We have seen the answer is no. Whether or not data hazard results in a stall depends on the pipeline structure. And for the simple 5-stage risk pipeline that we have discussed, only read after write hazard result in a pipeline stall. And instruction reading a register needs to wait until it is written. So, WAR and WAW hazards cannot occur, because all instruction take 5 stages. Reads happen in the second stage, we have seen. Write happens in the 5th stage. No way for a write from a subsequent instruction to interfere with the read of a prior instruction. So, we can conclude that for our simple 5-stage pipeline, only the first type of hazards, read after write type of hazards, can occur. The other two types of hazards, like write after read and write after write type of hazards, cannot occur, but there can be more complex pipeline. The pipeline depth may be much longer. Later on, we shall discuss some examples, and there this type of hazards may also be present. All I am trying to tell, for our simple pipeline, it does not, the second two types of hazards may not lead to, I mean second two type of data dependencies may not lead to hazard, does not mean they will not lead to hazard at any point of time. They can lead to hazard whenever your pipeline depth is longer or you have got different types of pipeline structure. So, with this, let us stop here. Thank you.